Hello. Hello. Welcome to the checkpoint this week with me, Vivian Kamsini. Now, after the twin bombings of Parliamentary Avenue and Central Police Station in November 2021 by the Allied Democratic Forces, Operation Shujaa was launched by the UPDF into the Eastern Democratic Republic of Congo to wipe out this enemy from source. But we still see this enemy coming to attack people at the bordering districts in Uganda, like we saw last week as the week ended in Kasese, to be specific, in Mpondwe, where a school, Lubiriha Secondary School, was attacked and left a number of people dead. In fact, 40 people lost their lives there. Now, prior to the Operation Shujaa being launched in Eastern Democratic Republic of Congo, the United States had designated the Allied Democratic Forces, an affiliate of the Islamic State, as a terrorist organization, and this was supposed to deny them the financial support that enables them to go ahead and wreak this havoc on people in the world. Now, here with me, my guest is Major Retired David Rusa, who is going to be discussing with me why does this continue and how can these ADF militia group be stopped from continuing to wreak this havoc? And welcome, sir.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Vivian.
Yes.
Well, it's indeed it is very puzzling. I've been reading a lot of things. People are condemning the government for not containing ADF. Some conspiracy theorists have been up and about. Some pseudo experts have been theorizing on what should have been done. But then, you see, many of us forget history. I recall very vividly ADF started in Mpondwe. I mean, by attacking Mpondwe in 1996. That was in the aftermath of the presidential election of 1996. And I think that was the first presidential elections we ever held, where President Museveni contested against the late Paul Simogereri. But I think it was October when ADF attacked Mpondwe from DRC again. So they say history repeats itself.
That's very interesting history.
Maybe
But
that's what it is.
sir, you are a security expert. You just talked about the pseudo security experts. Now we are talking about you, the security expert. And you have been the former director of operations at Internal Security.
I was actually a director one time of counterterrorism.
Okay. So you are very familiar with this kind of insecurities and the issues that we are going to be talking about. But first and foremost, who and where is the problem of the Eastern Democratic Republic of Congo? Why is it taking ages to resolve? Because as we speak right now, that is where their source is.
Okay, that's a very good question. The Eastern Democratic Republic of Congo, or the whole Democratic Republic of Congo, formerly Zaire, is almost the same land area as India, almost. Albeit with a smaller population, much smaller population. That is point number one. Point number two, DRC has been misgoverned since the time of King Leopold II. You know, DRC was called Congo Free State, and it was a personal estate of King Leopold of Belgium. And the Belgians made sure the Congolese were left in total ignorance. Very few people went got education. majority of the people were engaged in dancing and merrymaking. And I think at the time of Congolese independence, on 1st July, I think it was 1st July, 1960, there were about 6 graduates. Certainly the leaders were not among them. Patrice Lumumba was not a graduate. Neither were the others who took on after. So you can see a situation of people who were left behind in terms of modern knowledge. But they were very good at music.
And they also have lots of minerals there. They have lots of golds and other
minerals. Okay, we are coming to that. Mm. Now, in spite of that, the land, the DRC as a country, is one of the most endowed in terms of natural resources. They almost have all the minerals you can think of. They have gold, they have diamonds. In fact, when you go to Mbujimayi, it is called the diamond capital of the world. That's what it calls itself. You'll find people selling diamonds in the market, rather on the streets. Mm. Every small scale you see is not for weighing groundnuts,
but
for weighing precisely diamonds.
Diamonds, okay.
Now, just move a little distance away from the diamond, and how do the diamond dealers look like? Okay. Dressed in slippers and sometimes tattered clothes and not so well washed. But, as if that's not bad enough, you'll see people eating maggots. You know maggots? Yes, yes. But you'll find people eating. You'll find people eating maggots in eastern DRC. Well, this is to show you the level of neglect that the eastern DRC has been DRC in general has been subjected to. And that is not to say there were several attempts at secession, especially by Katanga province down south. So since time immemorial, maybe since the time of the great kingdom of Congo in the history, Congo has not had proper administration. The colonial times were hard times. The Belgians were very dictatorial. They treated the Congolese almost as if they were not human beings. Okay? And then when Congo got independence, these people did not even know what to do with power. They have always had problems from that time to date. Now, what does that mean? It means that any marauders or any terrorists will find very fertile ground in the Congo, especially the eastern part of Congo. Now, what makes Congo favorable for that kind of activities? One, Congo has very dense forests, tropical rain forests. In fact, almost the whole of eastern Congo is dense forest. So because of the dense forests, coupled with the vast territory, which is not properly governed, anybody can go to Congo and do what they want to do and get out. And then, of course, because of the misgoverned, Congo did not establish effective state structures. Well, with all due respect, the Congolese army is not known for being very efficient. That is, I'm not being condescending. But it's a fact that the Congolese army is not known to be very effective at dealing with enemies of Congo. Mm. And so you have got a lot of militia men in the eastern part. The most known is called the Mai Mai. Well, Mai Mai is a corruption of Maji Maji. Mm. I think if you're a historian, you must have read about the Maji Maji Rebellion in Tanzania in 1905-7. But now, these Congolese, what they call the Maji Maji, is a group of ragtag tribal militiamen who go around terrorizing people, extorting money from all manner of people who are transacting business, and killing at will.
Sir, you see, you are talking about the militia groups. In fact, it is said that there are over 100 militia groups that are there in the Eastern Democratic Republic of Congo. But also, you have said that the Congolese army is not efficient at dealing with the enemies. But there have been foreign interventions. There has been the UN peacekeeping mission, UNESCO has been there. As we speak right now, Uganda has an operation, Shuja, in Eastern Democratic Republic of Congo. Mm. There is the East African Community Regional Forces there that are fighting militia groups and rebels, talking about the M23 there. But this has not completely rid this area of these militia groups. What are these interventions doing wrongly? What are they not getting right?
Well, like I started saying, you need to look at the size of the Congolese territory. And then the vegetation and the kind of terrain. When you put all those things together, size, terrain, vegetation, then plus incompetence in administration, incompetence of the soldiers, you add an uneducated population which does not know its interests, which will not distinguish their interests from other people's interests, then you can see where the problem is. Right, like I told you, right from independence, Congo has not had an efficient administration, especially Eastern DRC. Almost administration in Congo stops in the big cities, Kinshasa, Lubumbashi, Kisangani, although it was also disturbed later on, Kananga, Mbujimayi, Bukavu. Goma has also been a theater of insecurity.
The biggest town, yes, in the East Democratic Republic of Congo.
Where there's a lot of insecurity. Mm. Beni and Butembo.
Actually,
have experienced
Goma is where the M23 are now.
Are now based. Yes, that's the area which they are always threatening.
Yes.
Then you have Beni and Butembo also susceptible to attack. You have maybe Bunya is a bit out of it. But in short, Eastern DRC is almost an ungoverned territory. It's almost an ungoverned territory. On paper, it's part of the DRC. Even they have officials, governors, I'm sure, district commissioners, and all other government officials. But how much do they do? I think these people are only there in name. Otherwise, the reality is, and even then, they do not go anywhere. Maybe they stop within a radius of about 5 kilometers. They don't go anywhere outside their headquarters. And another thing you have to note is that in DRC, officials have the discretion to tax anyone and any goods as they see fit. Maybe now it's a bit better. But during Mobutu's time, if you were an immigration officer, whatever you collected could be yours. Then you have local chiefs. They also tax their own way.
Well, from what you're saying, it's as though the foreign interventions that have come in to help the people of Democratic Republic of Congo also do not have a base upon which they have a system of enabling the Democratic Republic of Congo people to actually take up their own leadership and have institutions to deal with some of these threats that actually affect them at the local level.
Let's look at it this way. Mm. In order to help people, you must find them also organized so that you know you have where to start. But in the case of the DRC, there's almost nowhere to start. Now, you talked about the UN, I think it's called UNAMIR, or I don't know what UNESCO now.
It is the United Nations Peacekeeping Mission.
Yes, United Nations Peacekeeping Mission. Now, okay, let's even look at the whole concept of peacekeeping.
Yes, because the East African community.
Because you see, peacekeeping presupposes that you have separated warring parties. And now you are trying to find a way of building peace. But that's not what is happening. Peacekeeping itself, to me, is a misnomer. Because peacekeeping is normally supposed to be a temporary operation. It can't be permanent. You can't be a permanent peacekeeper like the UN have done. See, initially, we used to have peacekeepers where they would go to an area of belligerence or fighting, separate the fighters, and then they have peacekeepers there. But later on in...
They act as buffer...
A buffer zone, okay.
Yes, buffer.
But in 1995, it was realized that peacekeeping alone cannot guarantee security. And so they brought up new concept. Mm. There is peace building, which is not new, but which is always there. Mm. And then peacekeeping, of course, and peace enforcement. Three concepts. Now, in the case of the DRC, I think UPDF went for peace enforcement, not peacekeeping. Mm. Actually, it went to fight terrorists, which is peace enforcement. And I'm sure even the forces from Kenya, East African community, also went for peace enforcement, not peacekeeping. Now, the UN has been there, I think, since time immemorial. They have become part and parcel of the problem. They have been accused of all manner of crime, including even rape, defilement, illegal exploitation of resources. I think you have heard this, you are a journalist.
Yes, yes. The UN mission has yes. been accused by the residents there.
Now, the moment a mission is accused, it means it has no moral authority to enforce anything. And I believe that's what has happened. Because we thought the UN mission would be above suspicion, would be above board, would be respected by the local community. Mm. But it's not the case.
And also they have consistently been called out on the fact that they should be showing results for the whole time they have been there. And they always asked, what have you achieved from the time you have been keeping a mission here as the United Nations? And usually the answers are not exactly forthcoming.
There are no answers exactly. Because they have not achieved anything. Mm. And they have been there since, I think, 1998?
Early 2000s?
Early 2000s,
yes.
Yes. Yes. And you can imagine that's close to 30 years, I mean 25 years plus.
30 years.
And they have not achieved any tangible result. Now, because of the failure of the UN, they call them monitors, whatever they call them, because of their failure to deliver, that's how you get these
militia groups,
these lawless groups, like the Mai Mais, who are local militia, and then now the terrorist groups. Even ADF one time, brother, LRA at one time had some operations in DRC.
They actually say to be there.
Okay, it's possible. Then you have ADF, because I think ADF has now become native to Congo. Mm-hmm. They have been in Congo since 1995, I think. Because first of all, ADF was in Buseruka, in Bunyoro, until UPDF or NRA then flushed them out and they ran to Congo. And since then, they have been in Congo. Like very I told you.
Fact. Very interesting fact. Now that you've given us part of this history, tell us exactly how did the ADF get formed? How was it formed? And do you think that at the time of its formation, did they have legitimate concerns that actually took them to the jungle?
Okay. Well, ADF, they have a very interesting history locally here. In fact, ADF majority, if not all, are young men who belong to a Muslim sect called the Salaf sect. Mm. It's a fundamentalist sect. It is an Islamist sect. Last time I was here, I tried to distinguish between Islamist and Islamic. Islamists are those people who want to use Islam as a tool of hatred for others, as a tool of hatred for those who don't believe like they do. And these people are not necessarily non-Muslims, by the way. They are even opposed to moderate Muslims, to the orthodox Muslims who don't want to be fighting other people. Mm. So they even call them kafirs or kafars or pagans.
In short, they are radicals.
They are radical Muslims. Mm. That's what we call Islamists. Those people who look at Islam as a religion which must subjugate the others and convert them by force. And that's their doctrine. So these people, they called themselves here first Tabliqs. That was the issue around, right from 1991, by the way, I don't know whether you know that, they went to Old Kampala Mosque and killed people inside the mosque, security officers actually, policemen who were guarding the mosque, who had been taken there to maintain security. These people killed about five of them inside the mosque. And some of them were arrested and taken to Luzira. And it is in Luzira where they got even more radicalized. That's when they read radical literature. That's when they got even contact with some radical groups. That's when they met people like Jamil Mukulu, who was in turn linked to Osama bin Laden. I'm sure you have heard of Osama bin Laden, of Al-Qaeda. So ADF has been an affiliate, I think, of both Al-Qaeda and now here Islamic State. So you are asking, after that, when they got out of prison from Luzira, that's when they went to Bunyoro, like I told you, Buseruka, and they started a war. What was their objective? Aim to form an Islamic state. That was the aim, to form an Islamic state in Uganda where the Muslims are not necessarily a majority. So you can imagine now, how would you form an Islamic state in a land where Muslims are not a majority? It means you would have to do it through massacres, through
forcefully.
Force. Mm. And of course, the physicists say for every action there's an equal and opposite reaction. So if you want to use force to make people, to convert people, then those people you are trying to convert by force will also resist. And as a result, fire will erupt. And this is what has been happening. So, after in Buseruka, they were beaten, given a bloody nose. That's when they fled to Congo. 2 years later, they attacked Impondwe. And we repulsed them with heavy casualties. And that's when now they turned into urban terrorism. I don't know whether you were around Kampala in between 1997 and 2000, when bombs were being thrown in pubs, nightclubs, buses,
I was
taxis.
In Kampala, but just before we continue into that story, let me take a short break. We are going to be returning shortly and we'll continue with that story. I am Vivian Kamsini, and with me is Major Retired David Rosa.